In this chapter, we will look at Yarn, yet another resource negotiator in Hadoop 2.x, which is Hadoop's scalable compute platform. So let's quickly look at the agenda today. So I'll try to give you a short intro into the Hadoop and MapReduce version 1. And we'll talk about the inadequacies of MapReduce version 1. Then we'll get into the new architecture of Yarn. A quick introduction into Yarn, which is MapReduce version 2, and a quick insight into how to develop Yarn applications. So let's get started. So Hadoop clusters can scale from single nodes in which all Hadoop entities operate on the same node to thousands of nodes, where functionality is distributed across the nodes to increase the parallel processing activities. So the figure here illustrates the high-level components of a Hadoop cluster. So a Hadoop cluster can be divided into two abstract entities: a MapReduce engine, okay, which is part of the job tracker, and a distributed file system, which is part of the name node. The MapReduce engine provides the ability to execute map and reduce jobs across the cluster and report the results, where the distributed file system provides a storage schema that can replicate data across the nodes for processing. As you can see here, the data is replicated across four nodes in the cluster, which are also the data nodes. The Hadoop distributed file system was defined to support large files, where files are commonly multiples of 64 MB data blocks each. When a client makes a request to a Hadoop cluster, this request is managed by the job tracker. The job tracker, working with the name node, distributes work as closely as possible to the data on which it will work, which is also called as the data locality principle. The name node is the master node, or a master of the file system, providing metadata services for data distribution and replication. Moving on to the job tracker, it schedules map and reduce tasks into available slots at one or more task trackers. So as you know, task trackers run on each of the data nodes. The task tracker, working with the data node to execute the map and reduce tasks on the data from the data node. When the map and reduce tasks are complete, the task tracker notifies back to the job tracker, which identifies when all the tasks are complete and eventually notifies the client of the job completion. As you can see from this picture, MapReduce version 1 implements a relatively straightforward cluster manager for MapReduce processing. So MapReduce version 1 provides a hierarchical scheme for cluster management, in which big data jobs filter into a cluster as individual map and reduce tasks and eventually aggregate back to the job reporting to the user. But in this simplicity lies some hidden and not so hidden problems. First version of MapReduce has been both a strength and a weakness. So MapReduce version 1 is a standard big data processing system in use today. However, this architecture does have inadequacies, mostly coming into play for larger clusters. As cluster sizes exceeded 4,000 nodes, where each node could be multi-core, some amount of unpredictability surfaced. One of the biggest issues was cascading failures, where the failure resulted in a serious deterioration of the overall cluster because of attempts to replicate data and overload live nodes through network flooding. But the biggest issue with the MapReduce version 1 is the multi-tenancy. As clusters increase in size, it's desirable to employ these clusters for a variety of models. MapReduce version 1 dedicates its nodes to Hadoop, where it is desirable to repurpose them for other applications and workloads. As big data and Hadoop become an even more important use model for the cloud deployments, this capability will increase because it permits physicalization of Hadoop on servers compared to the requirement of the virtualization and its added management, computational and input-output overhead. Let's now look at the new architecture of YARN, or yet another resource negotiator, to see how it supports MapReduce version 2 and other applications using different processing models. A Hadoop cluster can be scaled completely linearly by adding more computers or nodes to the cluster. Computers in the clusters are called nodes, as we know. We have already seen how the increase in the storage capacity of the cluster can be achieved by adding more nodes with the disks attached. So these nodes also have their own memory and processing capacity. So we are also making more memory and processing capacity available to the cluster as a whole. With an increased number of nodes in the cluster, the compute time for the job for a given job will decrease significantly because the job can be spread across more processes. As in before, the costs associated with the cluster grow linearly. Cost per unit storage, and for that matter, the unit of processing will remain constant. And as discussed before, the compute time will decrease significantly because now we have more processing power at our disposal. Hadoop is specifically designed for cost-effective scaling out to a very large number of nodes. The largest clusters that are in use today are 40,000 plus nodes, and a bigger clusters of more than 40,000 nodes are also known to work. YARN provides a generic processing platform for running different processes at the same time. We might use different processing engines, which can be written in a variety of programming languages. So YARN supports running of many thousands of applications running concurrently. The core components of Hadoop are HDFS, as you can see in this picture, which is a distributed file system, and YARN, or the distributed compute platform. YARN is the architectural center of Hadoop, specifically designed to support many different processing engines, such as MapReduce, Tez, Spark, Storm, non-interactive SQL, real-time processing, real-time streaming, data science, and batch processing to handle data stored in a single platform, unlocking an entirely new approach to analytics. High-level languages such as Hive and Pig are compiled into MapReduce or Tez jobs where they are executed. Other engines have appeared recently which provide new capabilities using Spark and Storm for real-time processing. Before the advent of YARN, Hadoop was mostly batch-only processing model. YARN layer is introduced in Hadoop version 2, which allows other processing engines to be plugged into Hadoop, including some of which give near real-time capabilities. Thus, Hadoop is no longer batch-only because of the recent developments. YARN provides dramatic scalability improvements over Hadoop previous Hadoop version. So basically, YARN decouples the programming model from the resource management infrastructure. YARN delegates much of the job management tasks to the nodes in the cluster rather than in the master service, as we have seen in Hadoop 1, where Job Tracker was taking care of the management tasks. And YARN also supports much bigger clusters of 40,000 or more. YARN is a fundamental foundation of the new generation of Hadoop and is enabling organizations everywhere to realize a modern data architecture. So for the enterprise, Hadoop YARN is a prerequisite, providing resource management and a central platform to deliver consistent operations, security, and data governance tools across Hadoop clusters. YARN also extends the power of Hadoop to incumbent and new technologies found within the data center so that they can take advantage of the cost-effective, linear-scale storage and processing. It provides developers a consistent framework for writing data access applications that run on Hadoop. So with the advent of YARN, you are no longer constrained by the simple MapReduce paradigm of development, but can instead create more complex distributed applications. In fact, you can think of the MapReduce model as simply one more application in the set of possible applications that the YARN architecture can run. In effect, exposing more of the underlying framework for customized development. This is powerful because the use model of YARN is potentially limitless and no longer requires segregation from other more complex distributed application frameworks that may exist on a cluster like MapReduce version 1 did. It could even be said that a yarn becomes more robust. It may be able to replace some of these other distributed processing frameworks, completely freeing up resource overhead dedicated to these other frameworks as well as simplifying the overall system. So as you can see in this picture, at the root of the yarn hierarchy is something called as resource manager, which is the master daemon. This entity governs an entire cluster and manages the assignment of applications to underlying compute resources. The resource manager orchestrates the division of resources, which are basically the compute, memory, bandwidth, GPU, etc., to the underlying node managers. So these node managers are yarn's per node agents. Like if you look at Hadoop version 1.x, you have something called as task trackers, but here you have something called as node managers. So the resource manager also works with something called as application masters, as you can see here, to allocate the resources and work with the node managers to start and monitor their underlying application. In this context, the application master has taken some of the role of the prior task tracker, and the resource manager has taken the role of the job tracker. An application master manages each instance of an application that runs within the yarn. The application master is also responsible for negotiating resources from the resource manager and through the node manager, monitoring the execution and resource consumption of containers like CPU, memory, etc. So you may also note that although resources today are more traditional like CPU, cores, memory, tomorrow will bring new resource types based on the task at hand. For example, graphical processing units or specialized processing devices. From this perspective of yarn, application masters are user code and therefore a potential security issue. Yarn assumes that application masters are buggy or even malicious and therefore treats them as unprivileged code. The node manager manages each node within a yarn cluster. The node manager is a worker daemon which provides per node services within the cluster, from overseeing the management of a container over its lifecycle to monitoring resources and tracking the health of its node. Unlike MapReduce version 1, which managed execution of map and reduce tasks via slots, the node manager manages abstract containers which represent per node resources available for a particular application. Yarn continues to use the HDFS layer with its master name node for metadata services and also edit logs, and data node for the replicated storage services across the cluster. Each node manager tracks its own local resources and communicates its resources configuration to the resource manager, as you can see in this particular arrow here, which keeps a running total of the cluster's available resources. By keeping track of the total, the resource manager knows how to allocate resources as they are required. So use of a yarn cluster begins with a request from a client consisting of an application. The resource manager then negotiates the necessary resources for a container and launches an application master to represent the submitted applications. Using a resource request protocol, the application master negotiates resource containers for the application at each node. Upon execution of the application master monitors the container until completion. When the application is complete, the application master unregisters its container with the resource manager, and the entire cycle is complete. So let's also quickly talk about containers here. So containers are an important yarn concept. You can think of a container as a request to hold resources on the yarn cluster. Currently, a container holds requests consisting of vCore and memory. Once a hold has been granted on the host, the node manager launches a process called a task. An application is a yarn client program that's made up of one or more tasks. So for each running application, a special piece of code called an application master helps coordinate tasks on the yarn cluster. The application master is the first process run after the application starts. An application running tasks on a yarn cluster consists of the following steps. First, the application starts and talks to the resource manager for the cluster The resource manager makes a single container request on behalf of the application. The application master starts running within the container. Then the application master requests subsequent containers from the resource manager that are allocated to run tasks for the application. Those tasks do most of the status communication with the application master. Once all tasks are finished, the application master exits, and the last container is deallocated from the cluster. And finally, the application client exists. So here, the application master launched in a container is more specifically called as a managed AM. Unmanaged application masters run outside the YAN's control. So finally, a point that should be clear from this discussion is that the older Hadoop architecture, which is 1.x, was highly constrained through the job tracker, which was responsible for resource management and scheduling jobs across the cluster. And because of that, job tracker was clearly overburdened and it was frequently prone to crashes. The new YAN architecture breaks down this model, allowing a new resource manager to manage resource usage across the applications, with application masters taking the responsibility of managing the execution of jobs. This change removes a bottleneck and also improves the ability to scale Hadoop clusters to much larger configuration than previously possible. In addition, beyond traditional MapReduce, YAN also permits simultaneous execution of a variety of programming models, including graph processing, iterative processing, machine learning, and general cluster computing, using standard communication schemes like the message passing interface. And finally, if you're interested to develop YAN applications, so you can take a look at some of the options available here. So you can even develop a simple Java program which can be converted into a YAN application, right? So YAN internally provides capabilities to build custom application frameworks on top of Hadoop. So a boilerplate implementation of this lifecycle is also available under a GitHub project called Kitten. So the URL is already provided. So as a developer, you don't have to worry about implementing the core capabilities of YAN. So instead, you can use the Kitten project, and it'll always is going to provide you the complete implementation, and you just have to focus on your application logic. So in the next video, we will touch upon some of the new components, features that are available as part of Hadoop 2, and the core differences between Hadoop 1 and Hadoop 2. So if you enjoy this video, please subscribe to the channel for more upcoming videos. Thank you.